Good afternoon.
Thank you for inviting me to speak with you today about the Grant Wood Studio. But before I begin, I would like to take just a moment to thank both the Paul Mellon Center and the Henry Moore Foundation for hosting this convocation. And a special thanks to the Tara Foundation for American Art for providing the assistance that enabled me to attend this conference. The Grant Wood Studio was never meant to be a studio at all. It is, at its very core, a hayloft. This rather compact 975 square foot space with its sloping ceiling was nothing more than the second story of a carriage barn. It was a brick and wood structure built to accompany a Georgian revival style mansion constructed in the mid to late 1890s by George Bruce Douglas Jr. George Douglas, along with his brother Walter, were the co-founders of the Douglas Starch Works, an important early company in the Cedar Rapids, which by 1914 was the largest starch works company in the world. George Douglas Jr. and his family lived in the home until 1906, when they arranged a rather unprecedented house swap with Carolyn Sinclair, widow of Thomas Sinclair, founder of the Sinclair Meatpacking Plant. Mrs. Sinclair felt that her home, an 1886 brick Victorian, on the then outskirts of Cedar Rapids, was too large for her family, and the Douglases in turn wanted more property in order to plant formal gardens. It was during Mrs. Sinclair's time in the Georgian mansion that she decided to have the carriage house moved about 40 feet away from the main house. In 1917, 11 years after the house swap, Mrs. Sinclair passed away, and the property was occupied by her son, who in turn sold it in 1923 to John B. Turner, a local mortuary owner whose nearby funeral home had grown too small for his business. John B. Turner and his son David employed a friend of his son's, one Grant Wood, to help convert the mansion into a funeral home. The Turners added a large wing to one side of the mansion, and Wood designed, among other things, the rose-colored bay window in front of which the bodies were laying. It was John B. Turner and his son David who invited Grant Wood to use the hayloft as a potential studio, for they no longer needed the space for hay, as their hearses were all motorized by this period. This was a critical moment for Grant Wood. The hayloft reminded him of the garret he had occupied with his good friend Marvin Cohn on their trip to Paris in the summer of 1920. No sooner had he stepped foot inside the hayloft than he started to think that, with a little clever remodeling, he could transform this space to be not only a studio, but also a place to live. Drawing upon his arts and crafts background, that's exactly what he did. And in 1925, he moved in full time, bringing along his aging mother and frequently housing his sister as well. Not having to pay rent or a mortgage allowed Wood to give up his teaching position at McKinley Junior High School and paint full time. Wood lived and worked in the Grant Wood Studio until 1935, when he moved to Iowa City to assume a teaching position at the University of Iowa. It was in this studio that Wood created some of his most famous and iconic paintings, including American Gothic. The Cedar Rapids Museum of Art received the Grant Wood Studio in 2002 as a gift from the Lingy family. They own and operate Cedar Memorial, the successors to Turner Mortuary. However, as they say, there are no free puppies. Since that time, yes. Since that time, the studio has witnessed two major restoration projects. First, to shore up the structure and to convert the first floor garage into a visitor center. And then several years later, a second project to restore and preserve the exterior envelope of the structure, removing all of the lead-based paint, restoring the original windows, and securing the cupola. Neither project was inexpensive, but with the help of various donors, foundations, and historic preservation grants, we were able to accomplish this vitally important structural work, which totaled approximately $1 million. Despite all of this work, however, the interior of the studio itself remained relatively unchanged. Careful not to make any significant changes to the studio proper until we determine all of the interior work that needs to be done, we have had several analyses conducted of the various paint layers and later modifications, for the studio was more or less continuously occupied by tenants from the time Wood left in 1935 until as recently as 2000. What does this mean for our visitors? How do we provide an authentic experience in a relatively empty space? Our efforts to provide an authentic experience are perhaps best demonstrated by walking you through a visit to the Grant Wood studio. After parking in our lot or walking the three short blocks from the Cedar Rapids Museum of Art, the visitor is asked to enter the visitor's center first. Here, a staff member greets the visitor and explains that tours of the studio are by docent guide only, and that they are welcome to watch the introductory 30-minute film on the life of Grant Wood or view some of the other materials available in the visitor center for their perusal. The film screen, Grant Wood and Me, was something we produced for our major 2005 exhibition of the work of Grant Wood, celebrating the acquisition and opening of the Grant Wood Studio. It provides a nice overview of the life of Grant Wood and introduces viewers to some of his better-known works, as well as many works to which the docents will speak more directly on their guided tour. It also allows the docent to concentrate less on the biography of Grant Wood and more on the work he produced while in the studio. At the conclusion of the film, the docent, who has just finished up his or her previous half-hour tour upstairs, appears and gathers up the next group. This requires leaving the visitor center, at which time the docent discusses the nearby Turner Mortuary and Wood's role at that place. Rounding the corner, the visitors proceed up the modern stairs and stop at the top to look at Wood's door, I'm sure is what I say next. Wood's unique door, that is. Here we are. The door, a facsimile of the original now housed in the nearby Cedar Rapids Museum of Art, was fashioned from a coffin lid, readily available from the mortuary next door, in which Wood crafted a dial to inform prospective visitors whether he was in or out, and if the latter, when he was returning. It also let visitors know if he was having a party, out O-town, or even taking a bath. As you can see, I don't know if this is the pointer, but here he is out O-town, having a party, taking a bath. It's a wonderful dial, and in what was the viewing glass of the coffin. Upon passing through the door, the visitor is required to navigate a half story of narrow steps with a modern day railing to assist. For many years, people used the more rustic chain link railing opposite until the faux black end plates began to deteriorate. They are not a forged wrought iron, but rather are painted cardboard, saving this frugal artist some expense. You can see where it's flaking off. At the top of the stairs, the visitor enters a single large space, which served as a living, eating, working, and sleeping quarters for Grant Wood, his mother Hattie, and on occasion his sister Nan Wood Graham. The volunteer docents share several of Wood's modifications that transformed this hayloft into a home and studio for 11 years. These include the installation of a fireplace to warm the space. The hood is a metal bushel basket turned upside down. Originally, they heated their tea on that hood. To the right is the so-called hot dog stand, a drop-down eating space for Wood and his mother with a pass-through from the kitchen. Further right, a seating area, although the table is a later addition. Opposite is the sleeping area, where the single beds would be tucked under the eave and shielded from view by curtains during the daytime. The storage cabinets above could house not only painting supplies, but also clothing and other household goods. The dormer that Wood created by punching through the roof, allowing in western light and providing room for a desk. Painting storage racks can be found to either side of the dormer. These slide in and out to conceal and reveal the works that Wood was painting. These possess original wrought iron poles designed by Wood, as well as faux studded leather surface that Wood fabricated by using simple upholstery tacks and fabric, which he then painted. Original wrought iron lighting fixtures designed by Grant Wood, a modern easel where his original easel stood, the telephone stand on two levels, since one of them liked to stand when talking while the other liked to sit, the north windows, where hay used to come in from the alley. A window box seat covers the radiator that was installed during Wood's time. At some point during the occupation of the space, Wood punched through the roof on the northeast corner, creating a separate sleeping room for his mother. The large arched opening is able to be closed off by a hinged metal divider held in place by a clasp. Between the main room and Hattie's new room was a radiator to heat both rooms, with a stylized floral grill work on the living room side of the radiator. Hattie's room was heavily modified after Wood moved out, and thus now houses a couple of display cases holding a few artifacts, mostly metal work he designed and maiolica that he collected. Across from the entrance into Hattie's room is the bathroom, replete with built-ins and a sunken tub. The tub neatly fits the hole where the original internal ladder to the loft was and where the hay would be dropped down to feed the horses. It also allowed for both a bath and a shower in a rather confined and sloped space, thus serving both occupants, one of whom preferred to take baths while the other showers. The last room is the kitchen, which has been heavily modified and is in a state of disrepair. There was no stove during Wood's time, only a hot plate, but a small stove was inserted by a subsequent tenant. In addition, the more modern refrigerator has been removed since Wood only had a modest icebox. The docent giving the tour has a few props to assist with the visit. First and foremost, we are fortunate to have several black and white photographs of the space as it looked when Wood lived there. These are used and shared by the docent to help make the space come alive for the visitor. These historic photographs aid in the visitor's experience greatly. They demonstrate how Wood used the space, and the visitor can compare how the space was then and how it appears now. And there are occasionally details in the photographs that do not appear today, such as the curtains that used to hang separating the sleeping area from the rest of the room. Not only would these draperies have cut down on drafts and allowed for more efficient heating of the sleeping area, they also served as stage curtains for the small theatrical productions Wood and his friends would write and perform in the studio, thus establishing the first community theater in Cedar Rapids, known today as Theater Cedar Rapids. In addition to the historic photos, the docents may also use reproductions of a few of the works that Wood created while he lived in the studio. We had these made to their exact dimensions on masonite, a particle board frequently used by Wood and used with these same pieces. These reproductions include The Midnight Ride of Paul Revere, Daughters of the Revolution, Young Corn, Woman with Plants, which is a portrait of his mother, and of course, American Gothic. These five works represent a nice cross-section of the works he created while living and working in the studio. Each tells the story, and the docent is prepared to share that story. For example, the painting Daughters of the Revolution is an intentional parody of the organization known as Daughters of the American Revolution, who refused to dedicate the large stained glass window Wood designed for the Veterans Memorial Building because he had the window fabricated in Munich, simply because there were no craftsmen in the U.S. up to the task. It was at the time the largest stained glass window in the United States. The Daughters of the American Revolution, however, felt it was inappropriate to use German workers so recently after the First World War, even though this was 1928-29, a full 10 years after the end of the Great War. In his own commentary on the situation, Wood painted a trio of these rather prissy women, one daintily holding her cup, seated before a print of the famous painting of Washington crossing the Delaware. The irony here, of course, is that the painting of Washington crossing the Delaware, one of the most iconic images in America, was not American at all. It was painted by Emanuel Leutze, a German-American painter who painted the work in Germany using American tourists and art students as models. And the river is not in all likelihood the Delaware, but rather the Rhine. The history and humor of the painting is shared with the visitor by way of the docent. Obviously, the reproduction is not authentic, but the story is. Then, of course, there's the obvious. The docent can encourage the visitor to come to the Cedar Rapids Museum of Art. Located only three walkable blocks away from the studio, the CRMA houses the world's largest collection of works by Grant Wood, a portion of which is always on view. While our holdings of Wood's work number almost 300 pieces, some 60% of them are works on paper and unable to be on perpetual view. However, we do have a one-gallery exhibition that traces the trajectory of Wood's career, from his earlier impressionistic works through his works for hire to his mature work, ending with Spring in the Country, completed shortly before his death from pancreatic cancer, one day shy of his 51st birthday. So what are our goals for the future of the Grant Wood Studio? At one time, we had hoped that we might be able to populate the studio much as it was in Wood's day and to do away with docent-led tours, thus relieving us of the challenges of finding volunteer docents to give of their time and talents week after week. However, while we still hope to do the former, we are no longer considering the elimination of the docent altogether. For it is the docent that truly helps make the space come alive. While it might be easy enough to find original furnishings or reproductions of them, the studio would simply be a place full of objects without any sort of interpretation. A docent, whether giving a formal tour or simply in the space to answer questions, is critical in the storytelling world we find ourselves in today. And storytelling is what Grant Wood was all about. Each of his works tells a different story, filled with a narrative all their own, and their place in his life is a part of that story as well. The actual works of art can be found nearby, thus offering an authentic experience of the art, but the story of his life is what happened in the studio proper, and that continues to be the authentic story we tell today. Thank you.